Can machine think? Is it really useful to let them think? These are two questions that I posed at the end of a previous talk of mine. The first question is related, it has been proposed by Alan Turing, 1950, and is related to artificial intelligence. This is what we call strong artificial intelligence. If I ask you to define what artificial intelligence is, you probably would answer with one word, robot. And this is strictly connected to the notion of artificial intelligence, because a robot is an intelligent agent that needs to have certain features. Natural language processing, machine learning, automated reasoning, knowledge representation, planning, and perception. But unfortunately, we are far away from achieving this. The second question, is it really useful to let machines think, is connected to the ethics of artificial intelligence. Professor Stephen Hawking says artificial intelligence is going to be probably the worst things that happen to humanity, even worse than nuclear weapons and climate change. Elon Musk said, with artificial intelligence, we are summoning the demon. Do not panic. There is another definition of artificial intelligence, which is narrow artificial intelligence, also known as weak artificial intelligence. This is the state of the art of artificial intelligence. We are good at narrow tasks. And it's with this definition of artificial intelligence that I would like to answer a question. How can we empower education with narrow artificial intelligence? When I was a kid, I went to crash, like probably most of you. I was having fun, experiencing joy. I was self-exploring things. I had the chance to play with my curiosity. That was a dream. At the age of 9, my mom bought a computer. It was an Intel 286 processor. Yeah, the 5-inch floppy disk, an old one. But she didn't know what a computer was. I taught myself how to code, how to write software. I was playing with my creativity, nurturing my passion, developing my passion, nurturing my talent. That was a dream. Then I moved to secondary school. I didn't want to wake up. I wanted to stay in bed all the time. So my mom came to the room. Luca, wake up. Ah, I have fever. You don't have fever. So she gave me a thermometer. She went to the kitchen preparing the breakfast. Beside my bed, I had a little lamp. I placed the thermometer on top of the lamp, straight away 38. She came back, oh, you have fever. So sometimes I manage to stay in bed. I was cheating. But why? Why? 50% of students, of learners, are disengaged in our current educational system. There is a gap between the way we teach and the way we learn, the way our brain actually learns. Imagine the next line, teaching, and imagine the mental workload imposed on learners from teachers. And then imagine a white line, learning. The relationship between teaching and learning follow a U-shaped distribution. There is some students who are bored in class. Other students perceive instructional material adverse, complex, so the learning is minimized. And there are a group of students who enjoy the class and experience optimal learning. That means the current educational system based on standardization is not really working. One-fits-all solution doesn't work anymore. We need to have personalization. Then, I didn't want to continue my studies after the high school. I went to a software house. I was playing with what I like. I was writing software 8 hours a day. I was enjoying, but there was something missing. I was not learning anymore. So at some stage, I decided to go back to college. Why college was good for me? I had the freedom of choice. So what about education today? Do we really need a reformation? No, we need a transformation. So why don't we use what we are good at, narrow artificial intelligence, to actually empower education? I want to answer this with the NIPE cycle. On the X line, we have the timeline, the maturity of this narrow task from artificial intelligence, our technologies, and on the Y line, we have the visibility of these technologies and the expectation we put on them. This is not a scientific cycle in nature. It's my understanding, interpretation of the present, and my vision for the future. So here we have artificial intelligence, which is a trigger of innovation for education. We have optimization and distributed computing. This is what we call nowadays cloud computing. Free textbook, online free content. We can play with software online, and just pay a small amount of fees. Machine learning, a buzzword, omnipresent. Machine learning is a subfield of artificial intelligence. Giving a set of data, we can induce a model, and we can use this model for prediction and inform decision making. We go up to the hype, we reach the peak, data visualization. We have many visualization techniques online, the cluster data. And these are informed by data mining. Data mining is basically a technique borrowed from artificial intelligence that mine data from different sources and put together. And we are becoming good at smart data mining. We are at the peak of inflated expectation. Then we go in the future, and we will enter another period, a period of disillusionment. Here we realize that things that we thought can be good for empowering education are not really feasible. For example, virtual assistant, chatbots, automatic grading. These technologies are nowadays difficult to be implemented because of the limitation of artificial intelligence at tasks like natural language processing. Then we will enter another period in which we are enlightened, the slope of enlightenment. And here we have technologies such as virtual and augmented reality. Virtual reality is that technology that allows us to interact with an artificial system and artificial context with the headset. Augmented reality is another technology from artificial intelligence that allows us to explore real world with augmented object that can actually enhance our learning. We go up to the curve and we have mobile learning. We can learn from our devices when we want, where we want, how we want, and we will be able to create intelligent machine that will deliver content relevant to our devices, to our level of understanding of a topic. And then we will have another period of time in which we finally focus on the narrow task of artificial intelligence that can actually empower education. And we will reach a period of plateau productivity. Here we have learning analytics, metrics related to how we behave during problem solving, how we perceive the underlying learning task, how we react to this task, and metrics about the context. With these metrics, we will be able to create intelligent tutors. So pieces of software that using this metric can deliver relevant content to us according to our understanding of the topic, our expertise, our level. And finally, we will have gamification. Gamification is a technique that applies game principle to non-game context. And we will be able to create intelligent machines, intelligent agents that actually get the content from different sources and turn into a game. I would like you to focus on the last part of the hype cycle, the slope of enlightenment and the plateau of productivity. With virtual and augmented reality, we can actually self-explore things. We can play with our curiosity, creativity. With intelligent mobile learning, we have the freedom of choice. We can learn what we want to learn, how, where, and we can actually follow our passion. With learning analytics and intelligence tutors, we can actually personalize content to each single learner. And eventually, with intelligent gamification, we can nurture our talent and experience joy. So, with artificial intelligence, we can really unlock the power and the potential from each single learner. I want to go back to the origins. I want to dream again. Thanks.